Welcome to CU Sports Mag. I'm Amanda Blackwell, sitting alongside Adam McPherson. And Adam, it's Halloween weekend, and in true spirit, we've got some scary stories regarding CU sports.
Well, you know what? Of course, there are those scary ones, but there always are the good ones, just like this one. The Buffs men's and women's cross-country team won their 8th straight Big 12 championship Friday afternoon. On the men's side, the team scored a combined 36 points. Brent Vaughn led the team, finishing the race in 24 minutes and 39 seconds. All five Buff runners finished in the top 15. On the women's side, the team scored a total of 45 points as Jenny Behringer led the team in a little more than 20 minutes. The team hopes to continue their winning ways in the NCAA Mountain Region Championship Saturday, November 11th.
Well, any controversy surrounding Ricardo Patton's contract was put to an end on Wednesday. The longtime coach of the Buffs announced that he would resign after this season.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, with surprising news from Ricardo Patton.
Nor accept an extension of my contract, which runs until July 1, 2007. My staff and I will continue to work diligently to improve the program we began 11 years ago. Along with the recruits for next year, CU is clearly at the peak of talent in the men's basketball program. Whoever succeeds me will be fortunate in that sense. As I have said, with this talent, CU should be able to contend for a Big 12 championship within the next few years.
I think we're all surprised, you know, shocked, confused, because I guess a lot of guys didn't want to use that as motivation, you know, because I know especially for the freshmen, they say that's the reason why they came here was for coach. And, you know, it's kind of hurtful when your coach leaves. But, you know, that's a part of life. You have a lot of relationships. Sometimes they don't last. Sometimes they do. But you got to move on. You know, it's just a constant thing in the back of your mind. If you win this game, how is it going to affect him and affect his job? If we lose, how is it going to affect his job? You know, so I think that's the main reason why he decided to do this now. He didn't want that to distract us throughout the year. And, you know, so now we could use it, probably distracting as of right now, but, you know, we have a week and a half to put it behind us.
With surprising news from Ricardo Patton, Richard Roby on the Wooden Award list, and the release of the preseason rankings, basketball is the word of the week.
Ben Howell went to find out how students are reacting to this week's news.
With the 2006 and 7 CU men and women's basketball teams starting right around the corner and some surprising and rewarding news coming out this week about both teams, I'm here on campus to see what the student body thinks of their teams. Ricardo Patton announced on Wednesday that he would not be returning after this season. Is this going to be a concern for the Buffs, or can they win one for him?
I think Ricardo Patton's a really good coach. We've had him here for a while, so I think it should be a concern.
I think that the coach leaving is probably something that's pretty difficult for the team as far as like bringing in a new coach and having to get used to his sort of teaching and style of coaching. So it's probably definitely something that's a concern for the players.
I think the players backed him up really well. He sounded like he was doing it in the best interest of the players, so I backed his decision.
Richard Roby this week was named the Wooden Award preseason top 50 for NCAA men's basketball. How far can he get the Buffs this year? And do I smell tourney?
I think he's going to have a great year. I'm glad he didn't go into the NBA early. And he had a great year last year, so I think he can take us pretty far.
I think he can take us to the tournament, hopefully pass first round.
For CU Sports Mag, Ben Howell.
After snapping their 10-game losing streak against Texas Tech, the CU football team headed down to Norman, Oklahoma to take on the Sooners. Could the Buffs come up with another win? Let's take a look at the highlights. All right, well, obviously we know it was a tough game on both sides of the ball. Oklahoma was going to show some promise, even though they did have a backup running back in the game. But would it be enough for the Buffs to be able to keep – would it be enough for them to win against the Buffs? We'll have to take a look as soon as we can come up with that. Overall, Buffs played fairly well. Minor mistakes. Here we go. Looking at Washington taking it down. Thompson's going to go back, throwing down the ball once again. He's not going to get very far. Still making the move. Thompson once again is going to find his sweet spot in the end zone. Ooh, touchdown Sooners. Sooners up 7-0. After a quick three and out, Thompson went back to work as Broadway, got absolutely dominated by Thaddeus Washington. He's gonna need some Advil in the morning. The Sooners were forced to go for a field goal, and the ball is up and it's good. Now, still not being able to produce, the Buffs defense went back to work as Jordan Dizon introduced Thompson to the ground. Ooh, he's gonna make sure he gets really comfortable down there, especially after this play, dragging him down once again. Thompson thinks he's got something going with Kelly, who, cannot hold on to the ball. She recovers. It's time to go to work. Bernard Jackson's going to try to get the ball moving. That's not exactly what we were thinking of. He's going to get the ball down to Mel Holiday after getting it back. Holiday's going to have two great runs. It's just not going to be enough, however, for a first down and or a touchdown field goal unit. Are you kidding me? Mason Crosby misses it. Oh, dear. This is going to be a long day. Thompson looks to be getting a little cocky here as he's going to keep the ball. But Washington's going to explain why you really shouldn't do that right on this play. See, wrap up, bring him down, total domination. Finley's going to get the snag here. Coach, I'm going to go head-to-head with them. Can you hear me now? Good. Don't worry, though. The Buffs are all about sharing the love in this one. Kelly gets absolutely dominated. Ooh, that really hurts. Sooners say no more. Throw the punt up. Looks like the Buffs are going to get the ball. But Stephon Robinson not able to hold on to it. Alan Patrick's going to say thank you very much as he dives into the end zone. Buffs still scoreless. Fourth quarter, Jackson finds Cody Crawford for a first down. Nice jab there. Next play, Bernard Jackson's going to try to run the ball himself. He's going to do a little two-step here before finally being brought down. Next play, Jackson's going to go to the air for Tyson DeVries, who does his own little two-step. Not going to be enough. Let's see if the Buffs can go for a field goal on this one. Mason Crosby, nice to see you back. Puts the ball up for three, getting the Buffs on the board. It won't be enough, however, as Oklahoma beats CU 24-3. Now let's take a look at the Big 12 standings. Oh, I'm sorry. We're going right to the post game here.
The best of the North took on the best of the South in Nebraska. Texas A&M and Oklahoma State needed overtime to decide a winner, and the Baylor Bears clawed their way back to a comeback in Kansas. It all went down in Week 4 of Big 12 action. All right, those highlights, we've got, not going to ruin it for you, but we've got a lot of nail biters there. Each one of those came down to the last few minutes of the game. We're going to start off with Texas and Nebraska. Here we go. Just 2 minutes into the game, and they hit a 22-yard field goal for an early Texas lead. Nebraska's Zach Taylor launches the ball 63 yards down the field to Maurice Purify, who shows off a new trend called jogging. Apparently, you just run for an extended period of time. Into the end zone, 7-3 Nebraska. Colt McCoy with a nice little 6-yard toss to Quan Cosby. Give some thanks. Texas up 9-7. McCoy once again showing off the cannon that seems to have taken the place of his right arm. That's a 55-yard pass to Linus Swede, 16-7 Longhorns. Fourth quarter now, Zach Taylor gives a little flip to Brandon Jackson, who runs through the wreckage. Bodies are flying everywhere. Somehow he manages to stay on his feet and make it 49 yards into the end zone. This gives the Longhorns a reason to get a little bit nervous. They're now only up 16-14. But with just 6.5 minutes remaining, Texas puts up a field goal. They go on to win 22-20. Texas A&M at the Cowboys of Oklahoma State. This game's also going to start off with a field goal just 7 minutes into the game, and A&M goes up 3-0. Texas A&M, that's QB Stephen McGee to Martellus Bennett, who gets caught in some kind of weird jig with the defense, but ends up in the end zone 10-6 Aggies. Zach Robinson, 12 yards to John Johnson, making it look a little bit easier than it probably is supposed to. 13-10 Cowboys. Robinson wastes no time on that one. 22-yard pass to Adarius Bowman, who's just kind of hanging out there in the end zone. 2013 OSU. The big man Javorski Lane breaking through the Oklahoma State defense. Game's all tied up at 20. The clock runs out at 27-27. This is overtime now. Zach Robinson, 15-yard pass to Adarius Bowman. They needed a touchdown to tie it, but they forgot about the extra point. It gets blocked. Heartbreaker for Oklahoma State. A&M wins 34-33. All right, final Big 12 game of the day. Baylor starts things off quick with an early touchdown against visiting Kansas, 7-0 Bears. Kansas QB Kerry Meyer can't find anyone open. That's perfectly fine with him. He'll just take it 15 yards himself. We're all tied up at 7. Baylor looking to get the lead back on their home turf, but Aris Wright has slightly different plans.
He intercepts the ball and takes it back 28 yards to put the Jayhawks up 14-7. Baylor's going to try again, and this time they get it right. They go up 17-14 due to an earlier field goal. QB Meyer puts one up, and it's caught by Dexton Fields, who is doing his best Willie Mays impression. Kansas now up 35-17, cue the Baylor comeback. Quarterback Sean Bell with a ridiculous 42-yard pass to cap off a much-needed 80-yard drive. 35-30, Kansas, 1:08 remaining. Baylor needs a miracle, or at least Dominic Ziegler and his really cool dive into the end zone. Baylor scored 19 unanswered points to come back to win 36-35. All right, let's take a look at the Big 12 standings. Missouri's leading. They're tied with Nebraska. Both are 3-1, and we've got Iowa State and Kansas at the bottom, 0-4. Fortunately, the Buffs aren't at the bottom anymore. They've got 1-3. Big 12 South, no surprise here. Texas is 4-0. They lead Texas A&M right behind them at 3-1, and Baylor, surprisingly, not at the bottom. They're 3-1 too. We got Oklahoma State, who we just saw. They are 1-2 in the Big 12. That's the Big 12 standings for you.
Well, we apologize about the technical difficulties, but don't worry, we got everything squared away. And coming up next, we got a lot more CU sports.
Got pretty much every sport you could ask for, so don't go away.
Let's sit down for a second, please. Move.
There's Mary from your class.
Hi, Mary. Hi, Kayla. Come and play.
Oh, sweetie. Sweetie. Why don't you go play with those kids over there?
Why?
Imagine the power of one voice. Find yours at freedomcenter.org.
The Colorado volleyball team rolled past Texas Tech in a 3-game sweep on Saturday night. It was the Buffs' 7th sweep of the season as they defeated the Red Raiders 30-21, 30-27, and 33-31. In the first game, the Buffs never trailed, but the Red Raiders threatened in the next two. The final game was a tight battle, but the Buffs finished strong, scoring 3 straight points to seal the victory. Ashley Nuu had yet another strong performance, chipping in 50 assists. Alex Booth had 12 kills, and Lauren Schaefer added another 10. The Buffs had 58 digs and almost 7 blocks in an overall great performance. The Buffs volleyball team slammed the Texas A&M Aggies on Wednesday in College Station. Colorado won the last 3 games of the 4-game match, 30-20, 30-28, and 15-6. This is the second straight year the Buffs have swept the Aggies in Texas. CU recorded 70 kills on the night as setter Ashley Nuu dished out 58 assists. Alex Booth led the Buffs as she served up 4 aces to bring the team total to 9 in the match. Colorado is 12-7 overall and improved to 8-4 in the Big 12. The Buffs host Texas on Saturday at 7 p.m., and the game will be televised on Fox Sports Net Rocky Mountain.
This past Sunday, the soccer team played their last home game of the year against Baylor. Senior Katie Griffin, Laura Minnelli, and Allie True were each honored before the final match at Prince Hunt Field. Although it was Senior Day, it was a freshman who stole the spotlight once the game began. Nikki Marshall netted the only goal of the game to set a new single-season scoring record of 26 points. The Buffs' defense, headed by goalie Kristen Radulinski, held the Bears to just 2 shots on goal as they went on to shut them out in 1-0. With the win, Colorado is guaranteed a spot in the Big 12 championship in San Antonio, Texas. Their final regular season match will be against the Kansas Jayhawks this Friday at 2 p.m.
Kristen Radulinski, the goalkeeper for CU's soccer team, has had an outstanding week. She recorded 6 saves this weekend as her team faced Texas Tech and Baylor. With Radulinski's strong play, the Buffs recorded their 3rd straight shutout along with being named Big 12 Defensive Player of the Week. We here at CU Sports Mag have given Kristen Radulinski the honor of being CU Sports Mag Athlete of the Week.
My teammates are my best friends, and it's just the friendships and you know, coaches that you meet, great support. If I have that really good warm-up, I feel on point, you know, making every saves, good footwork. I feel like I could have a good game, got to be confident. I do kind of have like that feeling, like, yeah, I'm going to do good. But I like to say I have that feeling every time I step out on the field. So. I have a lot of pregame rituals. I'm very superstitious. It's like left shin guard, then right shin guard. The whole I pray before game. I see myself making every single kind of save possible. Listen to the same songs. And if you're out there watching me play, you'll see me. I kiss and touch every single post. It feels great to have a shutout game. It's always great when you could stop a team from scoring on you. It definitely is a confidence booster, not only for myself, but for the defense and for the team also. And definitely, it's not just like myself that has a shutout. It's always the defense. Hi, I'm Kirsten Redlinski, and I'm CU Sports Mag Athlete of the Week.
The CU men's golf team wrapped up the fall season on Tuesday with a 7th-place finish at the Pepperdine Club Glove Intercollegiate Tournament. Junior Michael Barrett, who transferred from CU from Pepperdine, tied for 13th individually, while leading the Buffs with a 58-hole score of 228. Junior Patrick Grady had a nice final round, shooting a 73. Grady finished the tournament in a tie for 20th. New head coach Roy Edwards says that with the team playing well this fall, the spring season looks promising. The Buffs will pick up tournament play the first week in February in Hawaii. Now, the CU tennis team looked to sophomore Monica Malewski, who led them through the 2006 Wilson ITA Central Region Championship on Saturday. Malewski took a BYU's Antonina Sukova in her quarterfinal match. Malewski won her first set 7-5, but eventually fell to Sarakova, putting the record at 9-3 on the year. Also for the Buffs, Martina Sedovic was eliminated in the round in 32, along with teammate Virna Nurmi. The team's next match won't be until January 23rd in Colorado Springs.
The Buffs football team is heading to Kansas this week to take on the Rock Chalk Jayhawks. With the Jayhawks' record of 3-5 overall and 0-4 in Big 12 play, maybe they could use some help from their mascot. Their popular mascot is the Jayhawk. Why don't they have a bird at the games like Ralphie? Pretty good trivia question.
That is a pretty good question.
All right, well, after the break, we're going to have double team, and we're going to have the answer to that trivia question. Yeah,
so make sure you stay tuned. We'll be back in a minute.
You know, we sing for millions of girls, but helping out in schools, that's the real deal, baby.
I know our love can multiply, 'cause you're the X and I'm the Y.
I'm the cute one, you know what I'm saying?
So, have you ever been backstage before?
Okay, guys, this is the Abacus, the old school calculator. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Like the circle and the square, our geometry is a perfect pair.
Now, why should kids know about gravity?
Well, gravity holds them down.
I once was one, but now we're two.
I'm spinning out of control.
Once is where my love to you.
Oh. Hey, welcome back. We're going to hand it over to double team now.
Aaron, Kelly, take it away for us.
Hello and welcome to this week's edition of Double Team. I'm Aaron Burgess, sitting alongside Callie Zanandri. It's midterm season here at CU, and we decided it'd be kind of fun to give our football team some grades of their own. Callie.
Exactly. The report cards are in from last weekend's game against OU, and we rated the Buffs in passing offense, rushing offense, passing defense, rushing defense, and special teams. Let's take a look at the report card, Aaron.
All right,
let's start
with
passing offense. What do you think?
Well, to start, when we talk about passing offense, you got to look at the statistics of your quarterback, Bernard Jackson. For the day against OU, he had 14 attempts and only 3 completions. He had one other completion, but that was to the other team. It was an interception. That's no good. Those numbers are terrible. 39 total yards on the day. You know, the only grade I can give these guys on passing offense is an F, Callie.
I agree with you. And along with that, I don't think it's just B. Jack's fault. You have to look at the O-line. They really need to give him some protection so that he can make those plays, the passes, et cetera. So the wide receivers also, they're not making the catches. They need to do that if we're gonna score and get on the board there.
They do need to make some catches, but still, I mean, 14 attempts, you have to have more than 3 of those fall complete. I mean, that's just, It's a no-brainer. That's an F out of the barrel.
Exactly.
So let's move on to the next category that's still on the offensive side, but on the ground, the rushing. Mm-hmm. What about that?
On the game, we averaged 2.5 yards per carry. Oh. Hugh Charles, our leading man, had 0.3 yards per carry on 30 attempts. That's just a little more than a foot. I think that's very, very poor football playing for the college level. There's a high school player could do better than that.
There's no question about that, Callie. I mean, the fact of the matter is Bernard Jackson, our quarterback, had way more rushing yards than your running back. I mean,
5.4 yards.
He had 54 yards on the day, and Hugh Charles had 2. I mean, this is ridiculous. This is another F for the Colorado offense.
Yeah, something's definitely going wrong with the offense there. So,
well, let's flip it over to the other side of the ball. Talk a little bit about defense.
Exactly, defense, passing defense, Aaron.
Well, I think they actually did a better job in this about passing defense because basically, OU, and so far their averages for the season, they've averaged 200 passing yards a game, which is pretty solid. However, against CU, they only had 105 yards passing. So I think our defensive or our cornerbacks did a relatively good job at stopping this guy.
Exactly. Half their average is really good to block them. I think I would definitely give them a B.
Yeah, I think a B would be good. I mean, obviously you're going to want them to step up, try to get some more picks, but a B is definitely a good grade for them. What about rushing defense, Callie?
Rushing defense, I think that Adrian Peterson was taken out, the Heisman candidate. This gave the Buffs a chance, but they didn't capitalize on it. The second string for OU came in, had 115 yards, one touchdown, and he's the second string. The Buffs just did not capitalize on this opportunity.
It would have been so huge for them to come back into that game and actually, you know, stop the guy, establish from the beginning that you can't run on us, and force him to pass a couple more, because if we have a good passing defense, we might have gotten some picks, changed that game around a little bit. But since we couldn't even stop the run, we gave him all day with that. And overall grade for rushing defense, I think it's a D.
Definitely. They definitely deserved a D. Let's move on to special teams, Aaron.
All right, let's do it.
Mason Crosby, he missed a 56-yarder, but he made one from 39. He put the Buffs on the board and, you know, made it so it wasn't a shutout. So I think he did pretty well that game.
He did relatively well. I mean, obviously, everyone at CU, they love him. They expect him to cross that 50-yard line. They expect him to hit those field goals. So 56-yarder, the miss, that was a little disappointing. But there's another side of special teams, and that's the punt returns and the kickoff returns. Stephon Robinson, late in the third quarter, fumbles the football on a kickoff return. No, you protect the football.
You cannot do that. You need to hold on to the ball, protect it.
So what grade are you going to give them on special teams?
I think special teams definitely got a C. They're average. There's a lot of room for improvement, and that can really make or break the game there.
It did. So those are our grades. Basically, when you total them up all together, that gives the Colorado football team a 1.2 GPA against OU. And if you look at that, and according to those numbers, they would not be considered academically eligible to play football in the NCAA with that kind of GPA. You know what, Callie? I think they should go home and show those report cards to their parents.
Exactly. I don't think their parents would be too proud, and neither are the fans here. I'm sorry.
Well, that's going to do it for us, a double team. We'll send it back over to the desk.
All right, thanks, guys. Last Friday found the men's hockey team at home for the first of a two-game series against in-state rivals from the University of Denver. The Buffs were able to control the game through two periods of play, taking a 4-2 lead going into the third. DU was able to put up a fight in the third, tying the game with two shorthanded goals. The Pioneers weren't able to hold off the Buffs for long, as CU took the game 7-5. The Buffs were unable to take both games in their series against the Pioneers, as they fell 5-3 to DU on Saturday in Denver. The Buffs will take the ice on the Big 12 tournament starting this Friday at 7:15 in Dallas, Texas.
All right, let's get back to that trivia question for this week. With the Buffs headed to take on the Jayhawks this week in football, why doesn't the school have a live Jayhawk at the games like Ralphie? The reason they don't have a live mascot is because the Jayhawk is a mythical bird, and it's a cross between a blue jay and a sparrowhawk. The Jayhawk wasn't the first mascot at KU. Previously, they had a pig and a bulldog. Very interesting.
Very interesting indeed. Though the season has been long and difficult for the Buffs football team, fans are already looking forward to next season and the long-anticipated debut of redshirt freshman Cody Hawkins. For more on the promising freshman, CU Sports Mag Phil Milani has the story.
Hawkins better like being around his family because the head coach is his father, Dan Hawkins.
Everybody who's around football, I notice, is the head coach. He kind of supervises the whole practice. And me and B-Jack and James, we work directly with Mark Helfrich, and he's not my dad, so we all get treated the same. And, you ultimately have to go out and prove it on the field, and I don't feel a lot of pressure because I have a lot of fun playing football.
Offensive coordinator Mark Helfrich likes what he has seen from Hawkins in practice.
Cody does a lot of things that are special, and we have a lot of our younger guys are doing some better things, and Cody has a lot of just that innate quality of being a coach's son and kind of that feel for football.
Even though things don't look good for the Buffs now, the future looks promising once Hawkins is leading the offense down this field.
When we start clicking, when we're going to hit it to that next level, we're going to start taking care of business, and I think the fans will be really happy.
For CU Sports Mag, I'm Phil Milani.
The CU ski team strapped on their boots last weekend as they began preparation for their upcoming season. As the defending national champions, the ski team has lofty goals and expectations heading into this season. The Buffs groomed 4 inches of fresh powder last Saturday in Boulder, and the Alpiners skied at Copper Mountain Sunday. In further preparation for the upcoming season, the ski team competed in the 26th annual Green Mountain Grand Prix in Chautauqua, Boulder. Tony Cecilini and Kit Richmond claimed the Alpine and Nordic titles for the men, while Lucy Zakova and Kit Richmond took the Nordic Alpine and Nordic titles for the women. All right, well, lots of things are happening this weekend in sports.
That's right. The football team is going to travel to Lawrence, Kansas to take on the Jayhawks Saturday at noon.
The Buffs volleyball team has 2 home games this week, first on Saturday against Texas and then on Wednesday against Kansas State. Both of these games are at 7 p.m.
The basketball travelers come to town on Thursday to take on the men's basketball team in an exhibition affair starting at 7 p.m.
Women's golf has a tournament in South Carolina Monday and Tuesday, and the soccer team begins the Big 12 tournament Wednesday. Hopefully Buff fans will find a way to root for their favorite teams next week. All right, well, that's going to do it for us at CU Sports Mag. For Adam McPherson, I'm Amanda Blackwell.
Have a good holiday, Halloween.
Yeah, Halloween this weekend. Have a great weekend.
It takes a man to be a dad.